Measurements. That's our first topic under metrics. Many objects have dimensions. Their height, thickness, and weights, as well as temperature, time, distances, length, and angles can be taken. When you see an object, you know these particular things. Now, when we're talking about measurements, we're like measuring the actual distance, the time, the values given to a distance, the time in seconds, the height, the length, and the angles of various substances, anything. These are various important things, various important parameters that we take. And under this stuff, they are all quantities, physical quantities, which we'll discuss about in our next discussions. Now, when you see a person, the first thing you notice is the person's what? Height. You notice the person's height, right? You want to know if the person is tall or short. The next thing you notice is the person's mass. If the person is fat or slim. And the other thing, time. Time always moves, right? And when you walk under the sun, you notice hotness or coldness. All these things around us has their own unique measured values. In taking this measurement accurately, there are some devices or instruments that are allocated to a particular kind of measurement. Now, these devices are called measuring devices or instruments. Now, what are measuring devices? Measuring devices are instruments for determining various quantities such as temperature, mass, height, length, voltage, and mechanical force. So we determine their instrument used for determining the values of various quantities. Now the quantities here are your mass, which is a constant, your height, length, voltage, and mechanical forces. Now let us take them one after the other, and because questions are mostly likely to come out from this place. Now under this session, we're going to be talking about the measurement of these quantities. Now let's take the first one, measure of temperature. Now, what's temperature? Temperature is actually the degree of hotness or coldness of a particular place. When you are sitting in your room, I believe that you should be sitting in an AC tight room. Yeah, that's the temperature there. The room should be cold. But if you are sitting under the sun, maybe you are cold for one reason or the other, and you're sitting in non-AC room, or you switch off the fans and your AC just for you to be comfortable, that's hotness. So that's called temperature. Now, how do we know if somewhere is hot or cold? Our normal human feelings is through temperature. It's true, like we feel it. But the instrument that I actually use in measuring this thing, and that instrument is called what? Thermometer. Now, under this thermometer, we have two different types of thermometer that we're going to be talking. Yeah, variously. Under temperature, if we go into the next session, which is optics and is, we're going to talk about the various thermometers. But because we are just doing some quantities and some major values in terms of measurement, these are what we ought to know. So we're going to be talking about one, a clinical thermometer that is used in the hospital to take measurement of health, your body temperature. And we have your bimetallic thermometer that measures different levels of heat in meters. That is heat in meters. In the next session, we're going to be talking about extensively the various levels of heat in meters. A meter can be hot and a meter can be cold. Joining wires together can actually produce current. We'll get to know about this in our optics, our next session, which is what? Optics and heat. Now, the next quantity that we're going to talk about is measure of time. Time is another physical quantity corresponding to phenomena or an event or happenings that is measured with devices such as watches and stopwatches or stop clock. If you've done pendulum experiment before, or if you're going for an occasion, usually take measurement of events. You want to know the time you're going to use for this event and the time you will be using for the next event. You take measurement with your time. So just know that for temperature, we make use of the thermometer. For measurement of time, we make use of what? Our watches. Now, for measurement of weight, under the measurement of weight, we're going to talk about, because when we're talking about weight, we can't talk about weight without talking about mass. What is mass? Mass is the quantity of matter in the body. Now, weight contains mass and acceleration. Mass and acceleration, that is weight. So the product of mass and is weight. Why? Mass is product of is the quantity of matter in the body. Now, the instrument used in measuring mass is a chemical balance. And why the instrument used in measuring weight is our beam balance or spring balance. Take note of this. For mass, chemical balance. For weight, beam balance or spring balance. Although we also have other instruments that are used for measuring weight, such as the bathroom scale, the electronic scale, analytical balance, unequal arm balances, and so on. But for your own, for the sake of exam, just know that chemical balance goes with what? Mass, correct? Why? Your weight, we use what? Beam balance and the spring balance. Now, then the next quantity that we're going to talk about is a measure of thickness. Now, what's thickness? Thickness is a dimension that corresponds to the distance between two surfaces. Now, when it comes to thickness, we make use of two major instruments called the caliper and the micrometer screw gauge. These are the distance. Then for measurement of length, you can see on the and in your screen, you can see the caliper and you can also see the micrometer screw gauge. Now in the measurement of length, we make use of length or distance. We make use of our meter rule. So our meter rule measures length. Shouldn't be twisted in any way. Our meter rule is for length or distance. So when you are asking a question, what instrument is for measuring length / distance, the next thing that should come to your mind is your meter rule. But if you are asked what instrument is for measuring thickness, then you should have two options here: your vernier caliper or your micrometer, which is the smallest of measurements. It should be noted here that our micrometer takes the smallest of measurements. Our vernier caliper takes a smaller measurement compared to our meter rule. Let's look at the calibrations of this instrument. The meter rule has a calibration of 1 millimeter. If you take your ruler and you look at your millimeter side of the ruler, the smallest calibration you can see there, the smallest counting that you can see there, is 1 millimeter. Before you get to 10 millimeter, you see 10 divisions that made up that 10 millimeter. So the smallest calibration there is 1 millimeter. For our micrometer screw group, for our vernier caliper, the smallest calibration there is 0.1 millimeter. And for our micrometer screw gauge, the smallest calibration there is 0.01 millimeter. So you can see that from these calibrations that our vernier caliper is going to take a smallest calibration, it can take a smallest measurement of 1 millimeter. Vernier caliper can take a even more smaller measurement of 0.1 millimeter. While the micrometer screw will take the smallest calibration or smallest measurement of 0.01 millimeter. Converting to centimeter, our meter will becomes 0.1 centimeter. And our vernier caliper becomes 0.01 centimeter. And micrometer screw gauge becomes 0.001 centimeter. So you should take note of those important parameters that I just listed to you. Now let's talk about our measurement of angle. Angle is formed when two lines intersect each other or when two planes intersect each other. And angles is always measured in degrees. The instrument used in measuring angle is the protractor, the theodolite, and the Bevel square. So, you will notice that in our description of the various measuring devices, we said that they are all physical quantities. What then are these physical quantities? Physical quantities are attributive elements or number of counts that describes everything our eyes can see, our senses can perceive, and what we can feel. For example, we can see an object as either being big, which is a large mass, or small, which is a little mass. Being tall, when we're talking about height here, we're talking about what, length or short. we can feel hotness or coldness, which is a temperature, right? Another physical quantity. We can sense that we are growing older every day due to the changes in our body. So that is what our time here. Now, physics measures everything we see, feel, or sense so that we can have directions of things. Now, examples of physical quantities, those things that we can see, like those things when we see things, we can be able to give the quantities of those things. Examples of these physical quantities are our mass. I told you that when you see someone, you can notice the person is fat or short. That is a mass. The time is always moving. It does not wait for anyone. Then the length, you're talking about the longness of a ruler, the shortness of a ruler, the height, the tallness of a guy, the shortness of a girl. This is under the length. Then the amount of substance, like your rice, amount of rice, amount of beans. This is another physical quantity. Then stress, strain. All these, when you have too much of strain in your body or stress in your body, it leads to an health condition. Now, what measures the amount of stress and the amount of strain are all physical quantities. All these are examples of physical quantities. Now, all these physical quantities that we know can be divided into two types. Now, the first one is our fundamental quantities, and the next one is our derived quantities. Now, what is the fundamental quantities? These are physical quantities from which no other quantities can be obtained from. They are the fundamental. By the word fundamental, it means that this is the last part. You can't go beyond this part. This is just the end part. That's just it. So fundamental quantities are physical quantities that you cannot get any other physical quantities from them. These are just the last of the last, the least of the least, the lowest of the lowest. No other physical quantities can be gotten from them. Now, under these fundamental quantities, we have our basic fundamental quantities and our supplementary fundamental physical quantities. Now, for our basic fundamental physical quantities, these are constant things that you always see. You always, when you look at one object, you see these three things personified in that object. For instance, if I take a look at my laptop in front of me or my phone in front of me, there are three things that instantly comes to play. As I'm looking at that laptop, what is going? Time is going, right? One. That's number one, basic fundamental physical quantities. Then two, when I look at that same laptop, I can see the fatness or the wideness of that laptop, right? That is what the mass. And I can also see the heaviness of that. I can feel the heaviness of that laptop. That is also what the mass. Then the next thing that I can see is how long that laptop is or how short that laptop is, right? That is what the length. So you can see that these three things are personified in that laptop. The mass, the length, and the time. Usually called our MLT. Mass for M, length for length, and T for time. There are supplementary physical quantities include our amount of substance. Under our supplementary physical quantities, we have our amount of substance, our radian, and which is angle, and the rest, which I'm going to discuss in the next review. Now, let's go into our derived physical quantities. Our derived physical quantities are gotten by the multiplication or division of two or more fundamental physical quantities. When you get two fundamental quantities and you multiply it, it can be two, it can be three, it can be four, it can be 1,000,000. That's how you have your various formulas. Getting so many fundamental quantities and multiplying or dividing it was what actually resulted in what the various formulas that we know now. So our derived quantities can be inexhaustible. As long as there are so many formulas, there are so many derived quantities to be discovered. But our fundamental quantities are just there. You cannot get any other fundamental quantities. I'm going to give you the list of all the fundamental quantities, then some list of the derived quantities. You should know that you cannot in any way List out all derived quantities. No, because as you keep on multiplying, you keep on getting what? New quantities. That's why it's called derived. New quantities being discovered. So that is our derived quantities. Now, all physical quantities have SI units. Now let's talk about the fundamental quantities and their SI units. Now, in this page, you can see the fundamental quantities outlined to you in a tabular form. Now, the first one that you have that we should know by now is our MLT. That's our mass, which is the SI unit for mass is our kilogram. SI unit of mass is our kilogram. So whenever you have a question and your answer, your work is given a gram, convert it to what? Kilogram. Now, for time, the SI unit for time is our second. So whenever you have a question and your time is given in hours, except you are told to specifically leave your answer in hours, or the answer in your option is showing, like I said earlier, the answer in your option is showing in hours, that's when you leave in hours. Otherwise, convert to what? To second. Then for the length, the SI unit is meter, not centimeter, except your answer or you are told to do so otherwise. But the SI unit of length is meter, represented as small letter, what? M. Then amount of substance, SI unit there is mole, represented as capital letter, what? M. Meter is represented as small letter M. Why? For your mole is represented as what? Your capital letter N. Then we have our intensity of light. Our intensity of light is our candela, represented as what? C. A candela represented as C. Then we have our angle. The SI for angle is radian. It can be given in gamma, it can be given in alpha, it can be given in beta, it can be given in omega, it can be given in theta. All these are what? For angles. Then for temperature, the SI unit there is Kelvin, represented as what? K. Then for electric current, the SI unit there is ampere, represented as what? Capital letter, what? A. So how many of the fundamental quantities have I given you? Let's count. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So we have just 8 fundamental quantities. Your assignment is to know these 8 fundamental quantities and their SI units. Some of the examples that you need to know is our velocity. And the fundamental the SI unit for velocity is meter per second. Now, from this fundamental, from the one thing I love about this derived quantities is that from this velocity, from this SI unit, you can actually get their formulas. Now, for velocity, we have meter per second, and our meter stands for what? Our length or distance. Then our second stands for what? Time. So the formula for velocity is simply distance, is simply distance over time. Then for force, which is usually referred to as what? Newton, represented as capital letter N, since Isaac Newton was one of the pioneer of force. So we actually use the name Newton to give him his accolade. Then the next one is our acceleration, which I have discussed earlier, meter per second square. Then our momentum is product of mass times velocity, kilogram meter per second. Our impulse, Newton second. Work and energy, joules. Power, watt. EMF, volt. Potential difference, volt. Resistance, ohms. Resistivity, ohmmeter. Density, kilogram per meter cube. Angular velocity, radian per second. Angular acceleration, radian per second square. Pressure, Newton per meter square. Surface tension, Newton per meter. And stress, Newton per meter square. Now you see these various derived quantities that I just mentioned. The reason why I just list them out is because we're going to be discussing in our subsequent review, or I should say sessions, not in our subsequent session, because we're going to actually say this, funny me, in this session. So in our next lecture or the next program, we are going to be talking about these quantities one after the other, the formulas and how to get them. So let's talk about dimensions. This is a relationship that shows how the basic fundamental physical quantities, that is mass, length, and time, is related to all other physical quantities. Now, when you hear the word dimension, it's actually a relationship that shows how the basic fundamental physical quantities, and what are our basic fundamental physical quantities? They are our MLT, that is our mass, our length, and time. Our MLT is related to every other physical quantities. Our MLT is related to every other. What is the relationship? So when I say find the dimension of velocity, for instance, I'm trying to tell you that break these physical quantities into MLT. That is the work here. So if I say find the dimension of acceleration, reduce it to the extent that I will get just mass, length, and time. I don't want to see any other thing, just mass, length, and time. In some instance, current is also among them. When we're talking about inductance and the rest, we're going to see current there. So if I ask you to look for the dimension of impulse, what am I trying to tell you? Break this impulse into what? MLT. So I just want to see mass, length, and time. Reduce it for me. That's just what I want to see. Now let's do some examples here. Example said that we have an example, a question shown to us, and it said we should calculate the dimension of the following: A, force; B, velocity; C, impulse; and D, pressure. Remember, our aim is to reduce them. Now let's bring out force. What's our formula for force? Our formula for force is mass times acceleration, right? So let's reduce them into what? MLT. So we have force equals to mass times acceleration, which is, now mass is already in its what? M, right? So we're not facing mass again. We are not going to look at what? Acceleration. What's our formula for acceleration? Velocity over time. Time is already in its T, because we are breaking them into MLT. Now, but velocity is not in either of these. So let's reduce velocity furthermore. Now, what's our formula for velocity? Length over what? Time. So in all these, bringing them together, we now have M times L all over T square. You know, we got the ML all over T square. Remember, our acceleration is velocity over time, which is L over T, right? And our velocity is distance over what? Time. So we have something like L all over T divided by T, right? Velocity is L all over T divided by T. So breaking it down, we have L all over T square. All the overs remain in one section. So we have L over T square. So our formula, we have it as ML all over T square, which is the same thing as ML T raised to the power of what? Minus 2. So when we are taking a number that is at the bottom, T square, to the top part, that we get the inverse of it, T raised to the power of minus 2. Let's assume that it's T cube that we have there. If we are taking it upwards, it's going to be T raised to the power of what? Minus 2. If it's T4, if we are taking it upwards, it's going to be what? T raised to the power of what? Minus 4. So that is our dimension. That's our answer for force. Now let's go to the next question. We are looking for the dimension of velocity. Now, our velocity here is what? Length over time. Now, since time is at the bottom, taking time up, you remember that T has a power of 1. A letter that there is no power written to it, you know that power, that letter has a power of what? 1. So taking it up is going to be T raised to the power of what? Minus 1. So we have LT raised to the power of what? Minus 1. So that's very easy. Now let's go to the next one. Impulse. Now, what's our formula for impulse? Our formula for impulse is force times time, right? Force times time. Now, what's the formula for force? From our subsequent question, if I want to break it here so that everything is going to be easy, I don't want to be referring us backward. So let's break it down. We'll have force times time, but time is already in its SI unit, is in our basic fundamental, which is T, right? So we're going to look for what? Force. So force is given as mass times what? Acceleration. Now, mass and time are in their what? Their basic MLT. So mass is M and T is what? T. So the only awkward one there is what? Our acceleration. And our acceleration is what? Velocity over time. If we further define this thing, we have LT all over what? T. So anytime we just have acceleration, just know that acceleration is always L all over what? T square. That is LT per square. You understand? That is L all over T square. Now, joining this together, we have ML all over T square times T. Now, T can kill one T at the bottom. So we're going to have ML all over what? T. So bringing that T upwards, we have ML T raised to the power of what? Minus 1, as shown on your screen. And that is our answer. Now let's go to the next one, pressure. Now what's the formula for pressure? Our pressure is force divided by what? Area. Force divided by what? Area, which is equals to mass. Our force, if we break it down, none of them here is in their correct like basic fundamental unit. So if we break force down, we have mass times acceleration. Now if you break area down, you have what? L, we have length times length, right? So if we break area down, we have length times length, isn't it? So bringing it up together, we have our mass times acceleration, which is m L T raised power of what? Minus 2 divided by what? Area. And our area is what? Length times length. You understand? So bringing it down, we have M L T raised power of 2 divided by what? L square. Now one L is going to cancel one L and the other L will cancel the other L. So here we have what? M L raised to power of what? Minus 1 times T raised to power of what? Minus 2. And that is our what? Answer for pressure. So you should note some certain things. LT raised to power of minus 2 was the same as meter per second square. And that is our what? Acceleration. Then LT raised to power of minus 1 is meter per second, which is our velocity. So we should just know that L to the power of minus 2 is acceleration and L to the power of minus 1 is velocity.